Thank you, Alderman, for joining us today. And thank you, Ed, on behalf of the National Trust for Historic Preservation and the Richard H. Driehaus Foundation, which was one of the primary funders of our work. We wouldn't be here today if it weren't for them. And I just wanted to thank all of you, Charles, and everyone in the community for inviting me here today to join you for this special occasion. Initially, Matt had asked me here to kind of talk about the Cornerstones initiative that we've been working on for the past couple of years, but I don't want to bore you with a laundry list because this is really your day and this is really here to celebrate everything that you've done. And so I just wanted to say that I'm very excited to be here with you today to celebrate the official listing of K-Town to the National Register of Historic Places. I think this is really a momentous occasion for everyone. And for the last 2 years, I've had the pleasure of working very closely with Charles and with Matt and with Anthony Rubano in the back, who's not getting nearly the acknowledgement that he needs from the Illinois Historic Preservation Agency, as well as a large group of incredibly enthusiastic and committed residents here in Lawndale. I cannot tell you how inspirational it's been to work with all of you. The goal of the Cornerstones project really was just to find new ways to help homeowners celebrate their history and tell their stories by preserving the incredible architecture that defines Lawndale in general, and K-Town in particular. And as a part of that process, I've had the opportunity to meet with so many wonderful people who are incredibly passionate about protecting this neighborhood and who have graciously invited us into their homes to tell us their stories and to share with us the architectural treasures that they've carefully maintained over the years, or in some cases, decades. And I just find that so impressive. And learning about the history of these buildings and the people who have made them their homes has only confirmed for us what so many of you already knew so very well, and that's that this is an incredibly important and very special place that is long overdue for this kind of recognition. And it was through the diligent research of our consultant, Elizabeth Logman of Midwest Preservation, that we were finally able to make this happen. We wouldn't be here today if it weren't for Elizabeth doing all of the research to make this National Register nomination possible. So it's my pleasure to introduce Elizabeth to you to tell you a little bit about the research that she was able to do for this nomination and the fascinating history of Lawndale that she uncovered. Elizabeth?
Okay. Thank you, Chris. Well, I'm delighted to be here today to tell you about K-Town. I know a lot of you have seen the presentation before, but I enjoy giving it every time because it's so fun to talk about this community. This is just a fascinating neighborhood. Just, you know, for the particulars, the neighborhood technically, according to the National Register, is bounded on the south by Cermak, on the west by Costner, on the north by Cullerton. And I should note that even though it's technically bounded on the north, it includes all the houses north of Cullerton. And then on the west, it's bounded by Pulaski. So those are the technical boundaries of the neighborhood, but let's take a look at what's within. One of the really interesting things about K-Town, and I think it's something that really distinguishes it from other communities, is the consistency of the building type. We really notice it's primarily single family, mostly either single family housing, or there are some two flats, some three flats. But the consistency is amazing, the scale is really remarkably consistent, and then we also had the commercial buildings that bounded it on some to the south and some to the east. But really, it's a remarkably intact collection of houses from the early 20th century. There are a total of 531 sites within these boundaries, and 495 were deemed to be contributing to the character of the district. That's a remarkably high level of integrity. We found that 18 were either extensively altered to the point that they were no longer recognizable, or they were infill, you know, so they were non-contributing because they were too new to be considered part of the historic district. We had a few empty lots, but really not very many. We found the integrity to be considered 93%, and this is pretty extraordinary. The district has been recognized for its architectural significance. For any of you who live here or have gone around, you've noted the beauty of the building, and that's why it's listed on the National Register of Historic Places. What you're looking at here is a builder's ad that we found from the Czechoslovakian newspaper. I know that Charles nodded to the Czechoslovakian origin of the neighborhood. Just to give you a little bit of background, the first residents were largely Bohemian, which is we use interchangeably with Czech. There are some technical delineations, but I won't get into them. A lot of the early residents were employed at the local industrial facilities. Of course, there was Sears, There was International Harvester, and there was notably Western Electric, which was very close to K-Town. There were so many Czechs employed at Western Electric that it was often known as Czech University because of a correlation between the residents who lived in this area and who worked at Western Electric. Because there were all of these Czechs moving into the neighborhood, of course, they had started out in Pilsen to the east, also a historic district and noted for its architecture. They began migrating to the west as they were looking for new houses. They were becoming increasingly prosperous, and they were expanding their community. So speculators began building the houses. Most of the houses built in K-Town were built by a handful of speculators, which is part of the reason that we have this remarkable architectural consistency, is that there were a number of patterns that they were working off of, and then they worked throughout the community with those patterns. The period of construction, as recognized by the National Register, is 1901 to 1931. And it's very remarkable how it fits into that tight time period of construction. K-Town is technically what would have been considered part of the larger California community. The Czechs referred to this larger area, including Pilsen, K-Town, and some of the surrounding neighborhoods. They referred to it as Czech California. And the reason was that they considered it to be their western paradise, much like the state of California. And hence the street names, California, Francisco, Sacramento. It was often described as being a beautiful community with well-tended houses, lots of flowers, and they took a great deal of pride in the construction and maintenance of the area. And here in this postcard, we did find a postcard, we believe it's from around 1915, that shows you what the area looked like. And I think it still looks very similar to the way it does today. So it should be pretty recognizable. You might even recognize some of the buildings there. I had mentioned earlier about the consistent types of residential construction within K-Town. Officially in the National Register, for the multi-unit, we recognized three primary types, the three-flat, the two-flat, and the graystone. Of course, part of the Greystone Initiative, there are a high number of beautifully maintained graystones within the district. It's very notable for the number of graystones and the quality of construction. Many of the buildings we found to be of a Queen Anne style, although there were some really remarkably unique kinds of styles, some very high style buildings. But the primary type of architecture within K-Town is Queen Anne. There are also single-family graystones, a large number of bungalows, and then the brick single stories. The brick and single-story graystones are really something that are pretty unique to K-Town. We don't see those throughout the city. It's a very large collection of these one-story graystones, which are oftentimes dubbed to be shoebox graystones because of the size and how compact they are. I think there's something that's really special to this community. We just don't see them around. But we did notice that they came up in some of the builders' ads, so it must have been a popular style at the time. We know that the Czechs took a lot of pride in their residences, and it was likely that even people, you know, that they wanted to take the style of the larger buildings and translate them into smaller buildings. So really something special for the neighborhood. We also have a number of building types for the mixed use and institutional. Again, a large collection of interesting architectural styles, a lot of Queen Anne. The boundary commercial buildings, which are to be found on the east and the south, also consistent from the period of construction. We know from looking at census records that many of them housed Czech businesses originally that supported the community at the time. So they really fit nicely into the narrative of the neighborhood. And to the building that we are at today, this is probably the most individually significant building within the district, the Jan Hus Memorial Building, originally constructed in 1915. It was built, as Charles mentioned, as the Bohemian Freethinker Building. There would have been a school here. They had a library. It was used as a community center. The Freethinkers were an interesting group. They're kind of a group of rationalist thinkers. One interesting story about this building, the construction began in 1915, which was the same year as the terrible Eastland disaster, in which a group of Western Electric picnickers were going out on a pleasure cruise out on the lake, and the Eastland collapsed, or it tipped over, capsized as people were getting on the boat, and hundreds of people drowned. There were so many Bohemians on board that boat that they had to delay laying the cornerstone for this building because it affected this community so dramatically. So it's just an interesting connection to a major event in Chicago, major tragedy in Chicago, but it really kind of acknowledges how this building has tied into that Czech community. It was built, the architect was a gentleman named Frank Randack. He built a number of the houses in the community as well, and he was one of the leading Czech architects working in this area. I had mentioned, you know, that the way that this building tied into the Czech community, I think it's also symbolic of the changes that happened in this neighborhood in the 1950s. Today, here we are in the St. Paul Church. The neighborhood underwent a dramatic shift in the 1950s. It went from being almost entirely Czech to almost entirely African American. And I think that's a very interesting portion of the story, because this is where we go to the part about stewardship, the block clubs, the residents who've invested their time and energy in maintaining the community. What we're looking at here is an article from the 1960s. There were a lot of community competitions for, you know, the most well-maintained house, the most attractive house, and K-Town residents often won these competitions. They would be held throughout North Lawndale. And I think this is really symbolic of the last 40 years of K-Town's history. Without the stewardship of the residents, we would not be here today recognizing this for its integrity, for its architectural significance, and for the character of the community. So while the Czechs built it, it's been the residents over the last 40 years who have really maintained the architectural style and the character of this community. So for everyone who lives here, congratulations. This is a great honor, and it's been a lot of fun to work on it. So thank you very much.